Hi, I'm State Senator George Maziarz, and I'm here with my colleague, Senator Mark Grisanti, and we're doing a dual show today?
It's kind of like a dual ad lib show, just towards the end of the session and see where we're at with some of our projects.
Well, Mark, you are new to the Senate this year, elected in November of 2010. How's it been? What do you think?
Well, I mean, I was happy that the budget got completed, as I'm sure everybody else was, although as painful as it was, I think our Senate conference made the budget a little bit better by restoring some of those items that were needed for schools and EPIC and the 4201 schools and Roswell Park and areas like that. But now that you get into this process of bills, you could feel in these next 2 weeks an onslaught of either repealing some legislation that's bad for New York State or legislation moving forward. That'll be good. So that's exciting. But I can tell it's going to be pretty crazy.
Yeah, it is. It always is the last couple of weeks of session. You know, one thing that, you know, and of course, we wanted to do this show together because of the differences in our career paths, I guess. You were outside of government and just got here. And I've been in the Senate for a while. But I think one thing that was clearly different this year was a governor. This is my fourth governor that I've worked with, and I can tell you that one of the problems of the last 4 years clearly has been, as I like to call it, a little bit of uncertainty in the executive branch. When Governor Spitzer was elected with 75% of the vote or whatever, he came in a lot of high expectations. He promised people a lot of things, and for personal reasons, which everyone's well aware of, he left, and then Governor Patterson came in. And I sat next to David Patterson for 12 years in New York State Senate, nicest guy in the world. But I don't think the legislative leaders ever really took David seriously, or gave him the respect that the executive deserved. There was turmoil in the Senate, and Speaker Silver, I think he saw it as an opportunity to take advantage of David. So you really came in at a very opportune time, and yeah. We have a governor who clearly has his goal set out for him, and he's going to go.
Yeah, and going back to Governor Patterson, I think he made everybody feel. I think he got the last laugh by basically vetoing everything that was on the table.
Yeah.
and stopping that certain legislation from going forward. But I think Governor Cuomo has been on track with certain issues that he wants to move forward and. And it's funny, like the property tax cap, we actually passed it first in January, and he's still going around the state talking about the property tax cap. The legislator needs to move on it, but he also have the mandate relief with it, which our conference is actually working on.
Sure.
With the mandate relief, just like our conference had an ethic commission attached to our conference, and that's another thing that Governor Cuomo wanted to do, and that's something that's going to get done too. So it's funny how, at least we're on the same page with things.
Yeah, we really debate things. I think that people always talk about three men in the room, but I tell you, this is the most open budget process that I've seen with the conference committees, with the committee chairs being very involved in it. Mark, we share in Niagara County, You represent
right.
The city of Niagara Falls, and I represent all the areas outside of the city of Niagara Falls, which sometimes creates a little bit of interest, I should say, from some people there. The lines are drawn the way they're drawn based on the census population. And I know that in Western New York, both in Buffalo and Niagara Falls, we've suffered the greatest loss in population. A lot of that I've always attributed to the fact that, it's a lack of private sector job creation.
Absolutely.
And, I know that we're working on a whole lot of projects for the city of Niagara Falls. I know you're working on things in the city of Buffalo.
Right. A couple of the main important things that we both talked about. We saw a wonderful expansion so far at the Niagara Falls Airport. Not only are they getting domestic flights increasing, but now they're trying to look at international flights. So we're stealing business from Southern Ontario.
Right.
One parking lot, as you know, and now three of them are filled up. There's five new hotels that are being erected as we speak. That's important to keep visitors actually in Niagara Falls? Because me and you were at a meeting, and what did they tell us? That the average stay in Niagara Falls, what, 2.5 hours?
It's measured in hours, not days.
Yeah.
Whereas on the other side, on the Canadian side, they actually measured in terms of days.
Right, and that's something to focus on. I mean, I've talked about with USA Niagara. They need to get together and expand the region for development to include the Aquarium of Niagara Falls.
Right.
We met with a gentleman from the National Comedy Hall of Fame that's interested in doing some work on the Main Street side corridor that has no businesses there whatsoever. You know, just creating those private sector jobs, getting rid of some of the red tape, regarding permit applications and making it more business friendly, because that's what I'm hearing, that it's not business friendly to come and do business. So
sure. Well, it's very difficult in New York in general, not in right. Certainly Niagara Falls is a microcosm of that. That's why it was so good in this year's state budget. The governor said, as previous governors have said, no new taxes, no new fees, no new assessments, no hidden charges at all. But the governor and the legislature, agreeing with him, kept their word. I mean, in this budget, we don't have any of those things right. That have been the course in prior years.
Yeah, no, and that's important. But you've got excellent legislation out there, too, with your Solar for Jobs Act. I know it's making its way through the committees. And that is huge on the environmental side and as far as creating jobs, because I think that'd be a perfect fit. GE announced that they want to have projects or they want to build some facilities in certain areas. Maybe we can land somebody like along those
sure.
lines. It was terrible, you know, the steps of what happened with Verizon.
Yeah.
That would have been good paying jobs, and it's just funny how somebody could just
yeah.
lock it up with one lawsuit. And then on the other side in Buffalo, as you know, because you've been an advocate for it with UB 2020, President Tripathi, the engineer of UB 2020, made some changes. He's happy with those changes. They were up here last week, did a great presentation. And it was a shame to see Speaker Silver kind of shoot it down and have a few words, which I don't really think he understood their plan. I think he does now. I had a talk with him afterwards and said, you know, their tuition is actually lower, and it's lower than any other
yeah.
campuses in the nation. So hopefully that moves forward, because again, that's construction yeah. jobs and permanent jobs at the end.
It really is, and UB 2020, of course, has been a hallmark of you know the time that you've been here trying to get that, and I know you talked to the governor about it, and Speaker Silver did seem to be the impediment for
right.
for a while. So it's great news to hear that he's finally understands it a little bit better.
And, yeah, yeah, and hopefully with that understanding, it's going to move forward. I mean, the schools need to keep the tuition so they can go ahead and implement their own programs, hire teachers, and use the money for their schools.
Yeah.
You can't have it swept into the general
yeah.
fund.
You know, I'm sure that you, like myself, meet with a lot of people who are interested in investing, and usually they want like heavy government subsidies. People talk about transformational projects, you know, the Bass Pro thing in Buffalo and,
right.
you know, the Main Street Courthouse in Niagara Falls. They were going to be transformational projects. They were going to create synergy and jobs and everything else. And, they've been, as in the case of Bass Pro, just went on forever.
Right.
In the case of the Niagara Falls Courthouse, I think it's been 3 years. You know, Main Street doesn't look much different than what it did when the courthouse went up there.
Sure.
But UB 2020, I think, in all of my experiences, I think this is one that really could be a transformational project for all of Western New York. I see it because my district stretches into Rochester. And I make this comparison a lot. And I know it's not exactly apples to apples, but the University of Rochester, they are to Rochester and the Finger Lakes region what Kodak used to be. I mean, you know, I always use the term, they own economic development. I mean, they run the healthcare system. Strong Memorial and all the other hospitals and healthcare facilities feed into Strong, and they're doing great. I mean, they have they get royalties from patents, from research that University of Rochester scientists have completed, and they're working on projects that are probably going to come to fruition, drugs and so forth, you know,
right.
after our lifetime.
Right.
You know, for
Absolutely.
The next generation.
Yeah.
And you know, they get...
Because it's not just an educational institute.
Right,
it's
exactly.
Now it's research and any of the incubator sites.
Millions of dollars
sure.
in royalties for that. That's what UB should be. That's what we want UB to be.
Right.
And that's why it's so disheartening sometimes, you know, when like Speaker Silver said no. You know, and again, I'm paraphrasing what my opinion is. His position was no. UB is part of a larger SUNY system, and they all have to be like a cookie cutter, pretty much the same.
Right.
You know, I'll tell you, I think UB could become the catalyst, moving the medical center to downtown Buffalo. Not only does it employ a lot of local construction workers, but hiring, hiring the type of scientists to do the research.
Absolutely.
The medical corridor there with Roswell and Hauptmann Woodward and that could be a huge boom for.
You got Roswell Children's Hospital eventually is going to be a catalyst down there, Buffalo General Hospital. To me, as I always describe it, it's the new. Like the new Bethlehem Steel, the days of manufacturing in Buffalo are gone. Now the focus on Buffalo, Niagara Medical Corridor, UB, and even the community colleges are getting involved by offering courses in radiology and physical therapy, and those are good-paying jobs. And you know, the more you complete, and like you said, if you have these researchers, they open up these incubator sites, and then those spin off jobs as well. So to me, it seems like the first 5 months being here that everything seems to be in the infant stages of a turnaround. Mm-hmm. You know, I could feel a turnaround of something happening. It's just a question of implementing these different programs. By the government being cut, you know, having authorities have accessibility and transparency, regional councils, I know the governor still has to work out on those things, but making it more streamlined and more friendly to do business here and not, you know, taxing everybody to death or regulating everybody to death. That's how New York's going to grow again, back to the Empire State.
You know, and I think the greatest comparison, and I've told this to the governor's senior staff people. You and I met with Pat Foy and Howard Glaser last week, and we indicated. I mean, we're in such a unique position. You know, everybody thinks, every state senator, assembly person thinks that they represent a very unique area in the state of New York. But where we are, you know, on the U.S. side, we can look across that Canadian border and see all of that development, see all of those construction cranes, see the city of Niagara Falls, Ontario, growing just, in our lifetimes, probably quadrupling in business.
Within the last few years, the businesses along Clifton Hill and the trademark restaurants like Jimmy Buffett's Margaritaville and Emeralds, I mean, those are places that should have actually... Been in Niagara Falls, so that's right. Something we'll fight, and that's something we'll work hard to get.
Exactly, and that's the type of synergy that can be created. And ironically, you know, we talk about government helping out those types of businesses coming in. It's almost better, I think, sometimes, or at least what private developers tell me, it's almost better if government doesn't help out, just stay out of our way.
I agree, because who better to know their own business than people that know how to run it and the people that are successful. So, yeah, when you have government that gets involved, it's too many hands in the cookie jar. I mean, and that can be a problem in the local development scene of both Buffalo and the city of Niagara Falls. You have too many hands in the cookie jar on what should be done.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of great ideas, and you just have to pick the ones that are going to work and make sure it goes forward.
Right, and, you know, we've got a meeting tomorrow with Ken Adams, the chairman of the Empire State Development Corporation.
Yes.
Talk about economic development in Western New York, specifically in Niagara County, where you and I represent, and talk about USA Niagara Development Corporation, which started 11 years ago now under Governor Pataki. And quite frankly, in my opinion, some of the results have been very disappointing, and I think we need a little change of direction there.
Yeah.
And, because we want Niagara Falls, New York, to be like that Canadian side.
We do. And you know, from what I've been hearing with Mr. Milstein being tapped to be the head of the Thruway Authority, and people saying, well, he hasn't done anything in Niagara Falls, you got to look at it like this. No developer wants their properties to be vacant.
Yeah.
He wants people to take their development. But with all the regulations and in-house funding, both locally and at the state government, nobody wants to come here.
Yeah.
So he doesn't want to just cut grass and pay taxes at $1 million a year. But he does a lot. He owns Niagara Aviations. He does a lot, and I know he wants to move forward.
Yeah. Well, Senator, thank you very much. This is great.
It's a fast time.
Okay. Yeah, it does go fast, doesn't it? Thank you.
All right, thank you.